Before I start my lecture, I would like to start with a confession and with a remark. My confession is that I am going to cheat tonight. In what way? Because my lecture is not going to be only about pottery. I will put in a little bit of architecture and also archaeology. Why? For two reasons. Number one, because I'm sure that not everybody is so crazy about Islamic pottery as I am. Secondly, because I have to put these pots into a context. So I would like to show you where these objects were coming up. And secondly, where they decorate a beautiful mihrab. So there will be a little bit of architecture and certainly archaeology. And the remark is about my involvement in North Africa. It was in 1976 when the British Academy has asked me to be the director of the Libyan Society's excavations at Medina Sultan, which is in the Bay of Sirte, precisely 55 kilometers east of Sirte. We had four seasons of excavations. I started in 77, followed the following year, 78, 79, and the fourth season was 1981. I have to add that I duly submitted my final report to the Libyan Department of Antiquities in November 1983. It's still not published. Fortunately, we have a copy in London, and we are going to publish it by the British Academy. So, can I have the first slide? As you know from history, by the end of the 7th century, or the first century of the Hijra, the Arab armies has already reached the Atlantic, and in 711, they crossed Gibraltar, Jabal al-Tariq, and occupied Spain, right almost up to the French frontier. By the middle of the 8th century, there were three major cultural centers in the Maghreb, in the western part of the Islamic world. One was at Cordoba, which became the seat of the Spanish Umayyad dynasty, while the other two was Fez, and the third was Kairouan. Until the end of the 8th century, North Africa was governed by Umayyad and Abbasid governors appointed by the Caliph, either in Damascus or later in Baghdad. Then, from 800 onwards, independent dynasties sprang up. First, of course, it was the Umayyads of Spain who chose Cordoba as their capital in 751. Then the Rustemis came to power, and the Aghlabids in Tunisia, and the Idrisids in Morocco. My story will start in Kairouan, where a beautiful mosque was built already in Umayyad times. It was a small building. You can see an aerial photograph of it there, and a very nice plan here. However, the building, what we see today, doesn't date back from Umayyad times. It was demolished by the Aghlabid Ubaidullah in 836, and he built a new one. Now, when he demolished the mihrab, the mosque, the people of Kairouan asked him to leave the mihrab untouched. They were very much devoted to that mihrab. Tradition says that indeed the mihrab is there behind the new one. But the new mihrab, what we see today, wasn't built in 836. It was built 30 years later, in 862. Now, then, you see, it's a beautiful building, with 8 entrances. First of all, that is the sanctuary. The sanctuary is preceded by a porch. That is the main entrance to the sanctuary. There is a dome above the transept, and another one just in front of the mihrab. Here is the northern part, and there is this beautiful minaret, which was really the first one that served as a prototype for all Maghribi minarets. Now, there are 8 entrances. Most of the entrances are like that, and I date back to the 9th century, so they were built in 862, except this one, which is called the Babla Rajane. That is considerably later. It was built in 1296, so end of the 13th century. But here, tonight, we are really concerned with the mihrab. If I may say so, it is probably one of the most beautiful mihrabs that was ever built in the Muslim world. Now, when you look at the entire niche here, you will see that it has the mihrab recess, has marble panels, and some of the marble panels are in open work. Now, scholars and the local people will tell you that is so, so that you can see through and you can see the old Umayyad mihrab. When I was writing my thesis on the mihrab, the origin and the development of the mihrab, I wrote to the then director of the Department of Antiquities, and I asked him whether that is really true, that the old mihrab is behind. He said, I just can tell you what the sources said, that the old mihrab has been preserved. I've been looking through, and there is something behind, but we don't dare to touch it. But obviously, that one day we will touch it. Now, I went there, I peeked through, and I could see there is a wall behind, but whether it is the Umayyad mihrab or not, I cannot confirm. However, today, we are concerned rather about these beautiful tiles, which are luster tiles. You can see it much better here. Now, I hope you will forgive me if I say a few words as an introduction about cluster. I know that Oliver Watson was here a few years ago and gave a very good lecture on luster pottery because that is his pet subject. But luster is a special technique. For the decoration of luster, you use either copper or silver oxide, and it requires two fires. First you fire your object or your tile, and then you decorate it and fire it the second time. Luster is an old technique which started in most likely, I believe it started in Egypt. That's why we went to excavate Bakasa, because I believe that it started in Egypt. And first it was used by the Copts, decorating glass vessels. It was the Muslim potters. Towards the second part of the 9th century, that they tried it on pottery, producing not only pottery vessels, but also tile work. Now, the earliest examples turned up in Samarra, decorating the large mosque and decorating the palaces, like, for example, the Castrolashic Palace here, that you can see here on the left side. Now, the last tiles, what you see there, that comes, it is now in Berlin, because Samarra was excavated before the First World War by the Germans, Sarah Herzfeld. It was painted in polymer. Strangely enough, it is a complicated technique, but luster started in polychrome, and then it became more simple, it became monochrome. Both examples, that decorated the Castrolashic Palace, and this vessel was found in one of the houses in Samarra, both dated and considered to be of the 9th century. So by the second part of the 9th century, when the new mihrab was decorated with luster tiles in Kairavan, the luster, the polychrome luster, was certainly firmly established. Now, according to a North African source, Ibn Naji, claims that the luster tiles which decorated the mihrab of Kairavan were imported from Baghdad, or rather, Baghdad, as far as we know, never produced such pottery, probably from Iraq. That is one possibility. However, when you consider that in those days it was a tremendous distance from Iraq to Karaman, it is more likely that these last empires were made locally. It was much easier to transfer the potters who were able to make it and then produce it locally. Furthermore, there is another evidence. When our Tunisian colleagues excavated nearby Rakado, not far from Kairouan, which was the seat of the Fatimids, they discovered pottery tiles, and luster vessels, and evidence for local production. Now, I can show you two examples here. One of them is in a private collection, that one over there in London, and this one is in the Halili collection, and both of them are claimed to have come from Tunisia. Whether they are made in Rakada or Kairouan, we don't know, but certainly the paste is different. That's what I would like to emphasize tonight. This morning, when I was interviewed by the TV, I was asked, how do we recognize North African pottery? One way to recognize it is to look at the paste. It's difficult to explain this because I have only the top part of the vessels, the inside of the vessel. You have to look at the paste, you have to look at the actual material. Now, for pottery, you can have, depending on the chemical composition of your clay, you can have white, you can have yellow, you can have pink, red, and even gray and black pottery, depending on the chemical composition. Because I was dealing with so much material in North Africa, I think I can now say that most of the pottery, particularly the glazed pottery, the type, the second type I'm going to talk about, which will be polychrome. I leave out the monochrome I mentioned in my synopsis that I talked about monochrome glazed wares. I leave that out for a very simple reason, because our examples that came up were not very exciting, very simple and very fragmentary. Now, if I go further, I take you now to Algeria. In Algeria, here in the south, almost due south, about 200 kilometers south of Algiers, up in the mountains, about 1,300 meters high, there is a famous archaeological site, Hala Banu Hammam. Hala Banu Hammam became the capital of the Hammadid dynasty in 1001. They started to build it. However, the life in Hala Banu Hammam was very short-lived, because in 1051, North Africa revolted against the Fatimids, and the Fatimids released the Beni Sulaim and the Beni Hilal. That was the Hilal invasion, and they destroyed a lot of sites in North Africa, in Libya, Tunisia, and Algeria, including Calais Banu Hammam. Calais Banu Hammam was a Banu. However, during that short period, as I'm going to show you, here is a view of Calais Banu Hammad. There is the minaret, but I will show you greater details. Here is the minaret of the mosque, the great mosque. Now, I know where it is because I've been there. Up there, you see a monochrome tile. Once upon a time, it was covered with beautiful glazed tiles, but that's all that was left there. Now, there are two palaces, or the remains of two palaces. That is called the Kasrul Bahari, or the Sea Palace, because it had a large pool here in the middle. And that was the other part of the palace. It was excavated by the French. Excavation here started quite early, at the very beginning of this century in 1906, and then they were completed by Galvin in the late 60s, when he published his final report. Now the second palace is the Castrol Manar. It is called Castrol Manar because, as you can see, there was a minaret or a tower, should be called a Castrol Burj. That is all that's left of it. Now here again, I found glazed tiles on the floor. So certainly, monochrome glazed tiles were used for decorating the walls and also the floor level. When the French were excavating, they discovered pottery kilns, and Galvin published the drawings of one of the pottery kilns as how it must have looked like in the days of the first half of the 11th century. These tiny pieces, I have to confess again, another confession, I picked it up on a colored band of Ammar, and it is now in the School of Oriental and African Studies study collection. Now, that is the second type of pottery that I am going to talk about. It is known under different names, but I think the best name is the polychrome painted ware, underglazed polychrome painted ware. When you look at it, you see that the paste is white. There are two possibilities. Either the paste is white or it is red, but a very dark red, so different from those of Egyptian, Syrian, or Persian wares. Now, I go further. North African pottery, particularly Fatimid pottery, complete bowls decorate the towers and churches of Italy in several places. Like, for example, the San Sisto in Pisa, which was built in the 11th century, and accordingly, according to the records, they are all from the San Sisto in Pisa, decorating the walls. Now, when you look at these vessels, you will see, by the way, as far as I know, I wasn't able to examine them, they are high up, and they were taken with a very good telescopic lens. They were painted in three colors, green, brown, frequently against the mustard or yellow background, and the designs are always outlined in manganese. Now, that is a special type of pottery, the source of which is really Iran. It was in Iran, in Nishapur, where this type of pottery, the slip-painted pottery, was first introduced towards the end of the 9th century. But by the time of the Fatimids, it reached North Africa. Even in our Bahnasa excavations, I found a few pieces of such pottery, but they were more at home further west, from Libya onwards, right up to Morocco and even in Andalusia. Now, there are two ways to paint it. Either the potter covered it with a white slip or a colored slip, which may be yellow or mustard color, and then puts on the design, or paints directly, if the paste is white, paints directly onto the paste without any ground slip. Occasionally, as you will see on some of my examples, the potter, for some reasons, didn't wait until the painting, the design got dry, but put on the lead glaze, the transparent lead glaze, and that resulted that when he put it in the kiln, the color started to run, as indeed, as you can see on some of my examples, on both examples. You see, here there is a ground slip, a mustard colored ground slip, just like on those, or it's yellow, but he didn't wait long enough, and the color started to run. Now, both of these objects came up for sale at Sotheby's. When I came to Sotheby's, I was a consultant between 82 to 84. They came in, and the head of the department identified them as the shop. I said, no way.
That is not Nishati. That is North African. And I attribute it to Nishia and dated it according to the 11th or 12th century. He didn't believe me. And I there sold at a very low price. One went for 120, that went for £60.
Now, after so many years, I realized when I showed these two, they ended up in a private collection, and I showed them to Oliver Watson and Professor Grube, and we all agreed that they are North African. Now, recently again, before I go further, let's go to Libya.
My story continues very soon. 55 kilometers east, there is Medina Sultan, or Sultan Kabino. Before the Umayyad, the Fatimids, occupied Egypt, they had, as you know from history, one great ambition to occupy Egypt. First they tried, in the middle of the 10th century, to occupy Egypt by the sea. That was a sea invasion, but they miserably failed. So, for these reasons, they systematically prepared the second invasion against Egypt. And along the coast, along the Libyan coast, you see that place was at Mandia in Tunisia, they built up fortifications which served as military bases for their invasion at every 25 to 30 kilometers. Well, because I was working here, that belonged to the area of Benghazi, so I come under the directorship of Benghazi, and I had the chance to travel all along the line, parallel with the sea, with the bay, and visited every military fortification, every 25, 30 kilometers, which served as a basis for the eventual invasion, which took place in 1969, when I successfully occupied. Now, there are two major sites between Sult and Benghazi. One of them is Al-Dabia, and the other one is Medina Sultan. Both of them were small cities. Now, that is a picture of Al-Dabia, part of the Fatimid fortress. You can see here, that is part of the Fatimid palace inside the fortress. There is a semi-dome surviving, and here is a sphinx dating back to the Fatimid period. Now, this site was excavated, that is the mosque, it was excavated by David Whitehouse, who is now the director of the Carnegie Glass Museum, Corning Glass Museum, and Anthony Hutt, who was my student. That is the base of the minaret over there. And that is the mihrab. That's what's left of it. And here they discovered plenty of this polychrome painted pottery. Now, let's go further. That is the site which I excavated. That is Medina Sultan or Sultan Kadima. Shortly after the Second World War, when Libya was under British administration, the British authorities organized the Department of Antiquities, and in 1954, the first survey was carried out at Medina Sultan. Then they discovered that Medina Sultan, you see, that is Medina Sultan. It was a walled city, a small walled city, lies next to a huge Roman city, which was called Iskina. And in Roman times and in pre-Islamic times, there was a harbor here. It's a very, very well sheltered harbor. That was the more detailed survey map. Here is again Medina Sultan, Sultan Kadima, and here are the remains of Iskina. Now, when we arrived there, before we arrived there, Dr. Mohammed Mustafa, who was the director of the Islamic Art Museum before,
carried out excavations at the request of the Libyan Department of Antiquities, and what he did, he produced that plan, that survey map, and he excavated the city wall between the north and the western gateway. From historical sources we know that the town has three gateways. The northern gateway, which is there looking towards the sea. Then there is the western gateway, and there was a third gateway but he was unable to discover. It's called the Babur Qibla, the Qibla gateway. However, he excavated the two gateways, and there are also in the historical sources dimensions three fortresses. One is up in the north, one in the southwest, one in the southeast. Now, Golven went there shortly before me in 1974 and excavated some houses next to the southeast fort. Here you see the north fort, and that is our survey map after our first season in 1977. Then there is the western, that is the northern gateway, and that is the western, southwest fortification. And here you see over there the excavated houses excavated by Golven, and that is the western gateway. Unfortunately, the southwestern fort was excavated by the Libyan army, and the result was they destroyed every possible wall. The answer is you never give such a task to a military because they are not trained for it. Now, Abdul Hamid, who was later then the director of the excavations, discovered the mosque. I will talk about the mosque in a minute. But in our last season, in 1981, checking the proper Qibla direction, I discovered the Qibla gateway. And there it was, that is the Qibla gateway. So we discovered it, but it very badly preserved. And then I realized why. Because at the bottom of the gateway, where the road is, I found an Italian perfume bottle, and I knew what happened. In the surface, the Italians built a road, and they carried out the stones for the new road. So they destroyed it. Now, the mosque. The mosque, as I said, was excavated by Abdul Hamid. What he discovered, that it was a Fatimid mosque, built before the Fatimids occupied Egypt in 969. It has a beautiful sanctuary with three transepts, you see. There is the transept and three arcades running parallel with the Qibla wall. I have to say something about the Qibla wall and the mihrab. The mihrab points, I have a Swiss Qibla compass, so I could check it. The mihrab points toward Johannesburg. And I saw my workers playing in a different direction. You see, that is the mihrab, that points due south to Johannesburg. And I saw my workers playing this direction, which is the proper Qibla direction. What happened? I think it was Suyuti who wrote that when a mosque was visited by the Prophet, peace be upon him, or by any of his comrades, the Qibla cannot be changed. It was Amr ibn al-As, who was a companion of the Prophet, who established this city, and most likely established the earliest mosque. Therefore, nobody is allowed to change it. However, today the people know in which way they have to pray. Now, he found that there was a minaret, that is the base of the minaret. You see, in Libya, the minarets were different. It had no internal case. It was a solid building, a solid structure, no internal staircase. But you went up through this fortified wall here on steps. So the minarets were not very high. Now, what was interesting, what Abdul Hamid told me, that he found two breaks here on the sanctuary facade, one here and one here. And he believed that there must be an earlier mosque there, which was probably established by Amri ibn al-As and used in pre-Fatimid times. Well, behold, when we arrived there in 1977, I found the break in the sanctuary facade, and I decided to prove his point to open a trench in the sanctuary. And as you see, that was before I opened my trench. Here we opened the trench, and the break continues. In the following year, in 1978, I opened another trench on the opposite side, and I discovered three floor levels. So indeed, there was an earlier mosque. Now, what was interesting of this trench? Most of our beautiful pottery comes from this trench. And that means that they are pre-Fatimid or just beginning of the Fatimid period. Now I come to the pottery. Sorry for all this introduction, but I had to talk about it. Oh, we also carried out excavations, what I called the central mound, which was really the Medina, the center of the Medina. That was the beginning of our excavations. And that's how it looked when we finished. I'm sorry to say, by the time we finished the excavation, as we all know, cameras go wrong in excavations, as it happened in Bakmasa as well. And here my camera just went wrong a week before the excavation, so my photographs are bad, very poor. Now, here again, in the city center, I found a lot of pottery of this polychrome painted vessel. But I come back to Nishapur. That is the Nishapur slip painted pottery. The paste is pink or red, and the colors are painted either manganese, yellow, green. These are the three main colors, occasionally brown. The decoration can be floral, it can be geometric, or it can be figural, as you can see here. Here is a figural design and a geometric design. So that is the Nishapur pottery. Now let's compare it to something different. I show you now two examples. This one came up as lot number 239 at the last auction at Sotheby's in April. And it is identified as Northeast Persia, or rather, to put it bluntly, Nishapur. It is not Nishapur. Over there is another one, which definitely comes from Cairo, and it is in the Gemeente Museum in The Hague, and it is attributed to Caravan. It comes from Caravan, excavated in Caravan, and it is a similarly polychrome painted vessel, just like this one. The beauty of this vessel is that it has a signature, Amala Abbas. And if that is so, if my conclusions are correct, that it is North African, and the paste is identical of both. Since then, that was sold, it is now in Copenhagen, and my friend, the director there, Kjell, accepted that it is North African. It has a special, very dark, not the terracotta red, but very dark red, rather a dark cherry red color, this paste. And you see the colors, the background and the design, and they are closely related to Nishapur, there is no question about it. It is only the paste and the details of the decoration which can offer us some help. Now, the very first piece from, such piece from Medina Sultan was published by Mohammed Mustafa after his excavations in 64. You see some ovals, overlapping ovals, but you will see more of it. And very frequently, I'm afraid from now on, my examples are all fragments, because we found many fragments. That is a crosshatch design. Or in the next one, again you see the crosshatch background. These are the bases of balls. beautiful bowls, or again a checker design and geometrical design here. These are rims of vessels. You see the overlapping ovals, and the decoration is green, brown, and of course the manganese always plays a significant role. That was our most beautiful example, and that comes from the most trench. That was the cavetto and the averted rim of a beautiful large plate. And here, again, a rim fragment, but you will see more rim fragments here. You see some intertwined cross, and here, and that is intriguing, here you see a series of heart-shaped motifs. And the heart-shaped motif appeared on several examples. You will see some more in a minute. Some beautiful palmets. You see, there are objects where the manganese carries really the design, and the green and the yellow or the brown is used only as splashes. There is a cypress tree. That comes from the Medina, and here is the base, the outside of the base of a bowl, and with an inscription which probably can be read as baraka, blessing. We had some figural decorations, but I'm afraid only fragmentary. There is the hand of a man, and here is the face of a man. Now, when you compare it to the Nishapur pieces, you will see that there is definitely close similarity. And here I have two ducks. Here is the head of that is a peacock, and that is another peacock, not ducks. So, these are the polychrome painted wares of North Africa. The question is, what is the origin? Well, the ultimate origin, I think we can trace them back to further east, to Egypt, Syria, Iraq, and Iran, these so-called splashes, which for a long time were believed to have connection with China, with the Tang pottery, three-colored pottery of the Tang period. In 1970, the Percival David Foundation of our school organized a symposium devoted to Tang pottery and the Near Eastern pottery, particularly the splashes. And there, Professor William Watson read a paper and said that the Tang three-colored ware was never exported. It was a funerary pottery. It was used in funerary occasions and was never exported anywhere. So the development of this type of pottery is quite independent from China. Furthermore, I could go a step further. Professor Alan Sari's excavations of Riyadh University at Karyat al-Fal produced very early examples where on the same vessel there are only just small splashes of brown, yellow, or green. And I date back to pre-Islamic times. So the development of this pottery is definitely Near Eastern. It owes its origin to Near Eastern potters. It took a time until the potters could work out that they could design vessels where the colors not run as they run over there. This piece I discovered among the ruins of Hirbat al-Majjar, the Umayyad Palace of Hirbat al-Majjar, when I first visited it in 1964 in Jordanian times, that is outside Jericho. And I took it with Auni Dajani, who was the director of the Department of Antiquities of Jordan at the time. We took it up to the Rockefeller Museum in Jerusalem. So it must be there. I hope it is still there. Now, and then from this developed another type of pottery, which is known as the Fayum ware, where the vessel is decorated with stripes, as you can see on these two examples. Now, There is an intriguing question here, and that's what I would like to, that's how I would like to finish my lecture. One can see a very strong Eastern influence or North African pottery between Iran and Iraq. But also at the same time one can see very strong remnants of Sasanian art. For example, the heart-shaped pottery, which played a significant role in Sasanian art. But I suppose that could be subject of another lecture. Thank you very much.